more before we, so let's move on to, would you like me to introduce you? So I want to thank you for volunteering. She actually insisted she wanted to come up here, and David even tried to talk her out of it and such. It's very rare, but she's so smart and so talented, and she has such a potent story. She's now an oncology nurse getting her doctorate, and you were in this Bible cult for 13 years and in and out of the mental health system that failed you for the most part until about a year and a half ago or so.
Yes.
So, yeah.
I may have missed it earlier, but what's your name? My name's Lara.
Lara.
Hi. Well, like Steve said, I'm really excited to be here. This is just like a testimony to Steve thinks outside of the box, you know, letting me come and share my story. I think it's a great way to teach. But I was in a Bible cult. I was recruited when I was 18 years old. I had been praying that God would show me the truth. I was raised as a Christian. My dad's a minister, and up until the age of 12, had a pretty normal childhood. However, after my parents got divorced, they both, for their own reasons, things got very chaotic in my family. So, you know, one of my vulnerabilities was this cult was a Bible-based, so it's that gave it legitimacy to me. This was something I was raised with. And then when we went through the recruitment, I learned that, oh, my dad's form of Christianity wasn't real Christianity. This is the truth. So that was one of the things that it was able to latch onto. But everybody has their own vulnerabilities. And every cult will use something different for every person. But because I had been praying that God would show me the truth, it didn't feel like I was deceptively recruited into anything. It felt like I joined, which that came back to haunt me years later. But I was in for about 13 years, and I was with my ex-husband for nearly 12 years. So the relationship was very much intertwined in the cult. It's kind of hard to separate the two. My husband was abusive. This is a Bible-based cult, and the Bible does say wives submit to your husbands as to the Lord. It says it in the Bible. Christians that aren't in cults still believe that. It does say husbands love your wives.
Fundamentalist,
yeah.
Orthodox Christians still believe that.
Yes.
And there are millions of them in the U.S.
Yes. And in practice, that might be different for everyone. You know, somebody that's not a domineering type person might not, you know, use that power in a negative way. But my husband had his own problems. Of course, he was being abused by the cult leaders in terms of being berated, yelled at, you have to fast, you know, everything is your fault, kind of like what Steve was saying. So we were leaders in the cult, very high leaders, as high as you could be without being paid by the cult. So like the cult leader, Kip McKean, you know, I sat across the table from him, was discipled by him.
Have you ever heard of it? The Boston Church of Christ? It was started in Lexington, Mass in 1979, by the way. It's all over the world.
International Churches of Christ. So so we led ministries, and we were very well respected in the group, very well liked. And then my husband started, some things happened. My husband decided we needed to step out of leadership. We were like the scum of the earth. But, and I will just say that as high up as I was in this cult, I was still very much a part of society. And from the outside looking in, no one would know I was in a cult. You might think I was an evangelical Christian. You might think I was very committed to my wonderful church. But you wouldn't know I was in a cult. I lived in the dorms. I went to art school. I was on the swim team. And eventually I worked for DreamWorks and Disney feature animation. So, and if I met you on the street, no, I would never, you wouldn't know the inside doctrine unless you were pretty far in the recruitment process.
By the way, I have your
my
drawings,
okay.
Whatever you want to use them.
So,
he's very talented.
My ex-husband decided to step out of leadership, and wives, you have to do what your husband says. So it was kind of cool for me because it was like all the pressure was off for a way, you know, for a while. And then, so the abuse in the marriage before he left the cult, he would throw things, break things, destroy property. He brought loaded guns into the house without my knowledge, threatened to kill himself if I didn't have sex with him every day. And one of the things that the cult taught us, my marriage counseling was never say no sexually. The Bible says, wives, your body is not your own. It belongs to your husband. Husband, your body belongs to the wife. So I'm only bringing that up because when he threatened to kill himself if I didn't have sex with him every day, I believe, had I not been under mind control, I would have said, this is a problem. I'm not going to be, because he never hit me or anything. It wasn't like that. I would have been able to say, okay, you need help. This has nothing to do with me. But because I felt like God had told me that I shouldn't say no, my leaders have told me I shouldn't say no, well, I'm wrong and I'm bad. And that just led me to completely submit to him and be really passive. So anyway, he left the cult. He was able to do so. And once he left the cult, the abuse changed in our marriage, because before he left, I would argue with him like a normal marriage, I guess. Once he left, now I saw the abuse as persecution. And now I had to be like Jesus, and I had to turn the other cheek. And he said I would get this crazy brainwashed look in my eye. He would tell me I was brainwashed, I was a cult member. He read Steve's book, but he used all that information against me. He's like, you're in cognitive dissonance, you know, you're using thought stopping. And he would not let me leave the room for hours, read the Bible with me. And then it escalated where he shoved me, pushed me, I fell down. He tried to smother me, threatened to kill me. So I became suicidal. And I actually encountered the mental health care system this is how I would have presented if you guys had known me. I'm having suicidal thoughts. My abusive husband thinks my wonderful church is a cult. Okay. So missed opportunity there for, you know, finding out more about how to help a cult member. We talked about safety, obviously. We talked about my childhood. This idea of being safe and leaving my husband and having a safe bag and having monies put aside, that was like a foreign language to me. This is my husband, God, till death do us part. So that didn't make any sense to me. But I actually went, the suicidality got worse. I was hospitalized voluntarily, and I was given misdiagnosed with borderline personality disorder. One of the nurses told me that I didn't, and I engaged in self-harm in the hospital. One of the nurses told me I did not do that until I had been told I was borderline. And there was this, you know, there's that influence thing where you're seeing everyone, how they're acting. People were cutting themselves, people were cheeking pills, you know, and I started to act out in those ways. And that's when I was given the misdiagnosis of borderline personality. Being away from my husband, though, was actually helpful. I was in for 3 weeks. I came out, and then I was able to leave my husband. I started with a new therapist. So now I'm starting with a new therapist. My abusive husband was telling me I was in a cult. Now she doesn't, you know, I'm still with him at this time, and then I leave him. And I was with that therapist for about a year, hospitalized twice more, and then I was able to leave the cult. But here's an important thing about insider versus outsider doctrine. It was humiliating for me to admit that this was a cult when I had told my therapist for an entire year how wonderful my church was, and that my jerk of an ex-husband thought it was a cult. So I didn't actually leave the cult until she went on maternity leave. And I was seeing a different therapist at the time, and who was covering for her, and I was reading Steve's second book, the one that isn't here, but that's the updated version of it. And she was like, why are you reading that? Like, they saw this as, I'm a suicidal person, this is a wonderful support system, why would you want to leave that, you know, or question it? So that was...
The cult was a good support system, they thought.
Because they thought it was a Christian church, because that's all I would have told them. So then I did leave, and in the next year, 2 years, I was hospitalized about 7 or 8 more times. The worst case was I woke up in the ICU. I had overdosed on pills, and I just remember waking up and thinking, being so disappointed I didn't see the bright light. You know, this was an attempt for me. I feel like, I mean, this is of course hindsight, you know, looking back, I wouldn't have been able to articulate it at the time, but that I was trying to get saved. You know, I would bring myself to the point of death, bring myself to the ER. I mean, I would go to the ER, take the pills while I was there, and say I just swallowed a bottle of pills and I wanted to be rescued. So that went on, and then I moved back to New York. This was all in Los Angeles. I moved back to New York, and I started seeing the same therapist I have now.
Didn't you do DBT before
no,
that?
No, I did it here.
Sorry.
No, it's okay. So I started seeing my therapist, and I only saw her briefly, and then there was insurance things, and then I was actually hospitalized twice more. My home environment wasn't so great where I was staying with my sister. There was a lot of chaos going on there. So there was a lot of distractions, you know, just in defense of my therapist, you know. There were a lot of things going on in the home environment that had nothing to do with the cult, and I was very suicidal. So I was hospitalized twice, and then I began therapy with my therapist. And for the next 4.5 years, I got better in a lot of ways, just not in the most important way, but I got more functional. Just to backtrack, I was on a lot of medications, and during all of those hospitalizations, like so many meds, and I gained almost 100 pounds. And I had other side effects too, long QT, I would see things with my hands and different things. But so when my current therapist that I'm with now, I started seeing her, and things got better in the next 4.5 years. So I went on welfare, then I got on disability, and I was able to go back to school, become a nurse. I became much, much more functional in many ways, but I was still plagued with this feeling, I guess what I'll get to. But so then there were a couple of triggers that happened, which I won't go into, but I wound up engaging in self-harm and then going into the hospital and I was again misdiagnosed with borderline personality and referred to a DBT program. So the DBT program, I was in the DBT program for 3 years, and I met Steve when I was seeing my DBT therapist, but it was, I have a lot of things I could say about it. I don't want to go into too much depth, but the thing I have a problem with is, first of all, I don't have borderline personality, so maybe some of those tools and techniques that work with people just weren't good for me. The 24-hour rule felt a lot like shunning. Here you are, here's this wonderful relationship, I'm your therapist, come to me, please call me if you need me, please. But if you make a mistake, you can't talk to me for 24 hours. That was very disturbing, very triggering, and I can say that it caused me to self-harm a few times. Because I would do it, and then I couldn't call her, and then I did it again and again and again. Because I'm like, what's the point, you know? So that was bad. But that was 2010. However, there were a lot of skills from DBT that made the very functioning part of me do really well. So I became more split. There was the part of me that wasn't functioning well, and there was the part of me that was functioning really well. And the part of me functioning well started graduate school, started a romantic relationship, started going on vacations with friends, started really doing much better. And I did stop the self-harm. I did. And then my teacher in grad school asked me to be her research assistant, and I said yes, and that involved recruiting. And I was like,
trigger.
What? I'm like, maybe I should get help with this cult stuff. So all of those symptoms, all of those years, none of that seemed cult related at all. I thought I was mentally ill. That's why I had joined a cult, right? I have borderline personality. I'm a very messed up person, and I had to join a cult where they would tell me what to do. That's what my belief system was. And then looking into the faces of all my therapists over the years, when you tell them about the specifics of being in a cult, they stare back so caring. They don't know what you're talking about, and you just feel like you feel more crazy because they're not giving you this. Like if you said certain things about a domestic violence situation, a therapist might say, that's abuse. It's not your fault. You know, very specific information. The cult stuff, they just don't know what to say. And that made me feel more crazy. This is also, of course, thinking back. So anyways, my work with Steve was amazing. The way I can describe it in a nutshell is that there was this part of me that was completely split off, and then there was this part of me that was really functioning, and what the work with Steve did was to integrate these parts. So dysfunctional Lara could meet functioning Lara and not need to call the therapist all the time, but say, oh, she's right there, you know. And that was like, before, my therapist was like, I know you know the functioning Lara. Can you put me in touch with her? Like, I couldn't access it. But Steve actually was like, okay, Lara, meet. It was really cool. So I'll go into some of my drawings, and I can talk more. I mean, there's so much I could say about the healing and the work we did, but also the integrating. So here's an idea. I could read Combating Cult Mind Control, and when you're in a cult, you're like so split off, you can just funnel out all the stuff that doesn't apply. Like, you're just so good at that. Like, but to really make it sink in, I remember I talked to Steve once, and he was like, why don't you read it again, like you're teaching the other Lara about it. And I was like, oh, that's a good idea. So I would read, you know, that really takes effort to read and be like, okay, Lara, cult Lara, what do you think about it? And then just hearing, you know, really listening, taking the time to listen. Oh, well, I don't think Kip's really a cult leader. I don't think, you know, like hearing all of that stuff and really to learn. So learning
to
work.
Just to reemphasize that, the idea is if you get out of the cult identity is still there and on automatic pilot, saying you got to go back. You need to be saved and such. And it was my notion was it's the part of you that wants to go back, that wants you to die, because you're not part of God's holy church, so therefore you need to exit, right? So instead of looking at the part as an evil spirit trying to get her to kill herself, I labeled it, it's your cult identity on automatic pilot, right? Remember, and I was saying, the real self has to exit counsel the cult self, and that's when she was saying, read it to, you know, the younger Lara, and go back into key moments where you had conflict, where you needed resolution, where you needed to exit, and put the tools where it needed to go. And I think also just me knowing I should also say when you first contacted me, I asked to speak with your therapist because I wanted, what's going on? You've been working with this person. And your psychiatrist said, Lara is the most functional and least functional person I've ever met in my career. And that gave me a lot of hope. You're so functional, you're going to do this. I'll share it with you, and you're going to figure out what you need to heal yourself.
Yeah.
And you, magnificent, wonderful. So here are some drawings.
I forgot to mention that symptom, though, that leading up into the DBT was I had this sense that there was an entity in my apartment. I had this feeling that something was trying to tell me to kill myself. And it was like, oh, this is a psychotic feature of depression or something. But I knew it wasn't real, but it was such a strong feeling. And when Steve said that your cult identity still believes that you need to go back to the ICC, because it's kind of like if this is a, let's say this room was, you believed, everyone believed that this is the only way to get to heaven was in this room. And now you're outside that room, even though if you've been programmed to believe that, you just can't see it. But I didn't know that that's what was happening until Steve, who had the experience and the expertise.
Or you can put on slideshow.
I don't use Max.
Here, press this.
For slideshow?
Yeah.
To make it bigger? Right there.
Yeah, we'll
maybe
the
first
turn.
On the
it
bottom
will.
Left.
Bottom left.
And then the third one to the right.
No, I think
right,
it's
still
just
on the PowerPoint.
This one?
Yeah.
All right, there you go.
But I think I may have skipped. Is that it?
The back arrow will make you go
you
back.
Got it.
Okay. So this is one of the drawings I showed to my DBT therapist, and she told me to draw something nice.
After this?
Yeah. Which I think that's just like how DBT is. It's very much like we don't want to, don't focus on this stuff. And maybe that works with borderline people. Maybe it worked. I don't really know. But for me, I needed to integrate. I didn't need any more help pushing anything aside. It was coming up and trying to get me. So these were just a couple of the drawings. Are you guys familiar with the wise mind model?
Mm-mm.
So it's like the intersection.
Oh, yeah.
So here in the middle, you can see the spiral of doom. So it's emotion mind, rational mind, and then there's like a little bit of wisdom, and right on the precipice of wisdom, for me, is this spiral of doom into hell.
Mm-hmm.
This was, I didn't know this was cult related, but this is what was going on in my mind when I'm wrestling with the wise mind. Did I put that? Oh, yeah. This is my interpretation of what the wise mind model should change to. Wise being, which incorporates reason, emotions, and your gut and body all together, not separated, not like emotions are some emotions you shouldn't listen to. I don't agree with that. Okay, this is probably not the best drawing, but this was like a pivotal moment in my work with Steve where I was trying to understand. See, my husband was telling me all the right things in an abusive way, and the cult was telling me all the, you know, and very enticing and like very nice to me, and that was very confusing for me. And when Steve and I were doing our work together, and he mentioned that you can't really generalize your marriage, it's like it was in a mind control environment, because I would always try to like think, well, why didn't this happen, why did that happen? I don't know, it was just a pivotal moment for me that I could control my own, even my own memories, and make them smaller and in the brackets of, oh, that's what happened in a mind control environment. And so this is just a little sketch from that. This is me trying to, again, figure out the wise mind model. I'm putting the church mind. I'm like super confused, right? Emotion mind, reason mind, wise mind, church mind, rejection mind. I was trying to work it out. Okay, these are inner child drawings.
So the expressive therapies are enormously wonderful, and somatic. Peter Levine's work is also really wonderful. But music, art, when she said, oh yeah, I worked for Disney, I did animation, and she showed me some of her work, I'm like, you've got to do artwork as part of your healing. And connecting to that resource, back to the cult.
And I will tell you, I did drawings, I did some drawings, and I had shown my therapist, and we talked about them, we looked at them, we looked at this like demonic thing I used to draw, and then I told you the DBT therapist was like, no, draw something nice. I couldn't draw for a long time. I just couldn't do it because the things I was drawing were so evil. You saw them. They just seemed like this is bad, or, you know, and it wasn't until I met Steve and did our work together that I was able to reconnect with that part of myself, which has been so tremendously amazing and healing. So these are some child drawings, healing drawings. You can't really see that, but it says, I'm me, and you can't touch me unless I let you. It's like, this is like all about boundaries. Here I was trying to use positive words. It says, happy, safety, together, secure. Instead of, you won't be alone, I was trying to write, you know, you will be okay. Mm-hmm. This is my little sketch of my work with Steve over the bridge to his house and different scenarios and stuff. Me on my journey. This is a drawing about the splitting of the mind that happened in the cult recruitment. Split selves. Okay, so I also started, hypnosis is a really big thing, and in the cult, hypnosis was used at, it wasn't like...
They didn't call it hypnosis.
No, I didn't know it was hypnosis until I actually did some work with Steve, and then he had recommended some, that he had mentioned that he had done some hypnosis work, and I got a referral from him, from someone else, to someone else who's
so
in my area.
So one of the people, yeah. My principal influence is Daniel Brown, who used to be head of training at Cambridge Hospital for 20 years, I don't know, 40 years ago or something. Dan Brown, the expert witness who helped all the victims of the Catholic Church sex abuse cases. He's co-author of Memory, Trauma, Treatment, and the Law. And he's working on a new book about attachment therapy, basically. And the orientation is to ask people to go back and had disorganized attachment or insecure attachment, to go back to key moments and imagine if they had the ideal mother and the ideal father, what they would have wanted them to say or do. And basically in trance, give themselves that experience, mm-hmm. a very positive healing experience.
So it's like utilizing your own power of creativity and imagination to heal yourself, which, so I actually do see a hypnotherapist in New York, and one of the things we did was look, you do this visualization where you're imagining the boundaries. Boundaries? Yeah, boundaries around your body. So this drawing is like kind of disjointed boundaries. I think these are out of order. And then this one is sort of a healing, like a more, they're coming together. It's almost like music, you know, like discord and then harmony. Okay, so this one is like the cult identity as the oppressor. And then this is like me going no to the cult identity. And these aren't about making beautiful drawings, you know, this is about healing. This is like me, again, with this inner child knitting together like a new healed inner world and safety. Same thing. I think I did this drawing after somebody said something to me that upset me, and I was just kind of needed, like, that it's going to be okay kind of thing. And then the ideal parents, you know, drawing myself as a kid.
Fantastic.
Thanks for listening.
So, I guess I want to open up for questions and answers, but I mean, literally well-intentioned therapists for 11 years?
Yeah.
Just kept giving you medications and...
Mm-hmm. Oh, I'm off all of my medications. Mm-hmm. I don't take anything. I tapered off very slowly after we started our work. Very slowly, like about a year it took. Last August I was on heavy doses of Seroquel. I've been on everything, Seroquel, Risperdal. I mean, like a lot of pretty heavy meds.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I just want to appreciate your sharing your story with us. It's very moving to hear, and it sounds like a horrible, trying, long journey. And it makes me wonder, when you kept having these interactions with new clinicians,
yeah,
and you kept missing the cues that you were giving them, what are some of the things that they might have said that would have, in that time of place, if you could think back to it, that would have helped you to engage, that would have helped you feel like you were being heard?
Well, I've thought about that. It's a great question. I think at different, since I met them at different stages, it would have been different things at the different times. But in the beginning, I think the therapist, you know, asking questions about the group, not in an accusatory way, and then them doing their own independent research, would have been good. But I've also thought about things they could have said, like, okay, your husband believes you're in a cult. Well, what, is there anything, like, what do you think about what he's saying? Now, I was on the fringe of the group at the time. I may not have offered that information at all. But asking what I thought, because you're not allowed to think. You're not allowed to think your own thoughts, and you're not allowed to think critical thoughts. And I may not have, when I was in the group, been able to express any negative thoughts to the therapist, but even just the question and giving me the space, because my husband didn't want me to think either. He was like, you need to leave, that's a cult. There was not like, Laura, what do you think about what he just said? And like letting me have the space. I know I sound like Steve, because that's what you always said, letting
no,
me have the space.
Look, what I say to my clients who come to me because their son or daughter or whoever is involved with a mind control group is not, the goal isn't to get them out of the cult. The goal is to empower them to think for themselves and make their own decisions. So instead of giving conclusions or judgments, think about questions from a curious yet concerned, compassionate place.
Yeah.
That will get them feeling respected, go inside, and try to make sense of reality.
And I think, too, a big thing for me was that every time I was hospitalized, I was told I had borderline personality. Mm-hmm. However, every outpatient therapist I had said, you don't have it.
Mm-hmm.
But no one helped me make sense of, why are they telling me? And when you don't, when you've been in a cult, I believed something with my whole heart and my whole soul and my whole life for 13 years and found out I was wrong. So why am I going to believe you if you tell me I don't have it and they tell me I do have it? Who do you trust? I was reading books about borderline personality. I'm like, this must be what I have, you know. And my therapist that I have more recently was like, but I told you didn't have it. I'm like, that's not enough. When you've been told, when you don't believe, you don't even trust your own self, what did I have then, you know?
And it sounds like you went through a lot of being told all
yeah.
sorts of things and not a whole lot of being asked.
And this was also like as
exactly
recent,
well said.
As
right.
recent as 2010 when I was in the hospital. Now this was my first hospitalization that I had ever had where I hadn't, except for the first one, where I hadn't engaged in self-harm. And I had been safe for about 4 months and hadn't done anything. And they're like, you have borderline personality. And now I hadn't been in the system for 4 years, 5 years almost. And I'm like, actually, no, I don't have it. They whipped out the DSM, sat me down 3-1, which felt very much like a Bible study, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
Breaking session. That was how exactly how it was. Yes, you do have it. Look, you have this, this. Now, I wish they would try that now. I wish I could just, you know.
In your mind.
In my mind, I can
them?
Fix that moment, you know. Huh. And it was a resident, and I don't know, it was like a resident and an intern, and someone, I'm sure they were well-meaning. But that wasn't helpful. And my therapist, my outpatient therapist, knew I didn't have it, and there was, that wasn't being communicated, and what was the treatment plan?
So I put on the slide of my former cult leader and his wife, by the way, and I was saying true parents. That was father, true father and true mother for 2.5 years for me.
Yeah, and you know, my father, when I told him about Steve and meeting Steve and doing the work with him, my dad is so clueless about cults, and even now, mm-hmm. about, even though I've tried to explain it, he was like, oh, I met the Reverend Moon, and oh, he was like all happy about it. Like, no idea of the danger of this, of what I was in.
Because it's mainstream.
It's
if
very
you notice, mainstream. You know, because they own the Washington Times, there's no negative news about Moon or any, like many cult stories even in the mainstream media. This is one of the mass weddings. Identical wedding dresses and identical suits. And the men are lined up, the women are lined up, and Moon goes, you and you. You and you. Get married. And they're often separated for 4 years before they're allowed to engage in marital relations. The children are often taken away, raised communally. Crazy stuff. I did want to highlight a therapeutic piece that's very significant that will be good for your toolbox, is the whole issue of triggers we've been talking about. So we have 5 senses, so we can be triggered in any of the 5 senses or combinations of the senses. And explaining to people, hey, that's how we learn. We have associations, you know, good things and destructive things. And I often use one of the first big triggers for me when I got out of the Moonies was the word moon. Because mm-hmm. when someone would say, hey, did you see the moon last night? That's what I was kneeling before him at a lecture. And I was like, no. So what was that trigger? A, I was going back in time to an association to my cult identity, right? Not the Steve was out, but I was back in my cult identity kneeling, right? So teaching my clients, hey, we don't have to go back to a traumatic moment associated. We can make a movie or a picture screen and see the younger me kneeling, but I'm here in the present, safe and sound. I don't believe Moon is a messiah. He did, but I don't. So when I think of Moon, it's over there in the movie, and not a big one, like what I was doing initially when I was getting triggered. It was life size. Small little picture, you can make it black and white. It's real small. And again, it's a mind control technique, except you're controlling your own mind, is what I'm teaching my clients. And what I needed to do is, in my case, because I was recruited when I was 19, the strategy is, well, how did I used to react when I would hear the word moon before I got into the group? Oh, I imagine the satellite that goes around the Earth, right? So then I would deliberately take the trigger, the word moon, and I'd see the satellite that goes around the Earth and repair the association so that I have a normal reaction to a stimuli. Does that make sense? So I'm literally explaining it like it's that simple. And I have my clients, okay, make the association. How do you want, and if someone was born in the group, how do normal people react to the trigger? You know, how do normal people react? And just have them pair the reaction they want to have with the cue. And we learn very fast as humans. We can make new associations really fast and use them as the default and have our cult memories on as a dissociated memory, if you will, of that was what happened to the younger Steve. Yes?
I have a question about, for either one of you or both of you, about social isolation and kind of loneliness that goes with having had this experience, because I imagine that a lot of people you meet aren't familiar with your life experience and don't, you know, just don't have, just as you said, your therapist didn't, this would be true in your social world as well. You know, you meet people and they're not really familiar with what you've been through. They may not have a good grasp of it. It may be difficult to discuss. There may be all kinds of reasons, which I imagine would be quite lonely. And at the same time, I think of being in the cult or being in the church or what have you as probably having had a pretty strong social component, right? You're around other people, you're very together, you think the same way, you do the same things. And
you're kept busy all the time.
And you're busy, and that's the lifestyle, you know? And so here you go kind of from this one lifestyle full of people that you're together with to this other lifestyle where you're kind of doing all this really hard work, probably kind of on your own.
Yeah.
Now, being a therapist, you know, one thought that comes to mind to me is like supportive group therapy, but I could instantly imagine that that might be a little scary because why would you want to join a group?
I'll tell you something very important, that all of these healing modalities, group therapy, all of it, really great, even the hypnosis, everything. The understanding mind control and what happened takes away the shame of the event. That has to happen first. So one of the triggers that led me to, before my hospitalization, was a holistic nursing conference where we did visualizations. So you think, oh, visualization, isn't that great, isn't that healing? Freaked me out. I thought someone was taking over my mind, and that's when this idea that there was something in my apartment was trying to kill me came back. Okay, but after understanding the mind control experience, going through it with somebody like Steve, and who understands it, and then you don't have the shame of it. Then something like visualizations, hypnosis, groups, all that, then they don't have the power anymore.
Okay, so. From a like a stage model, I mean, if we're thinking sort of therapy models, this individual therapy piece is really important for learning these skills, doing the psychoed, learning some new ways of thinking about this. But at that point, maybe being part of a group of people who've been through a similar life experience might be kind of helpful.
Yeah.
And is life lonely in this new place, or? Have you been able to?
It's, you know, there were a lot of other things besides the cult that happened at the same time with me, with the divorce and losing that whole family, moving 3,000 miles away, career change because of layoffs, because of the digital age, taking over hand-drawn animation. A lot of things happen, and starting over is just hard no matter what. But I am able to let people into my life and let them know. But I did tell them I was in a cult. I told people I was in a cult, and I have really good friends. But I couldn't tell them that I was cutting myself and that I was on all these meds. It was a deep, dark secret. Now that I'm healed, you know, no, it is lonely. But I'm learning, you know, who can I let in? How far can I let them in? You know, and there is a group actually in New Jersey that I went to in October for former cult members, run by a social worker couple.
Her brother was in the Moonies in the 70s, and how she got interested.
Yeah.
It's the longest running ex-member support group in the country.
But I heard about groups like that before, and I was like, why would I want to be in a room with a bunch of crazy ex-cult members? Like, I thought I had been crazy for joining. Well, you need to destigmatize it for yourself and learn what happened to you before you can even, you know, and I did. Along the way, you know, your clients will give you clues. I told my therapist along the way about Steve and his website, and I don't know if I wanted them to be able to say, yes, you can trust this person, you should do this, and maybe I shouldn't have needed someone to tell me, but it would have been nice if they had known you need exit counseling.
Mm-hmm.
Even, you know, Margaret Thaler Singer, you guys know of her?
Mm-hmm.
Is that her name?
Yeah.
And I was watching a video lecture of her in 1990, 1, I think it's from, she did research, she was a PhD, did research with ex-cult members, had like a N of 3,000, like wrote, described all these people's cults experience, says they absolutely don't need therapy when you're coming. First, you need exit counseling. Then, because therapy is, there's a problem with me, I need a therapist. The cult is not a problem with you. You need a consultant, and the consultant is someone that helps you with a problem that's outside of you. And then after that, if you want therapy, great. I needed therapy, I had childhood issues, I had a lot of things, this is all good. But you can't just like ignore that. Big, especially for me, it was 13 years, you know, I mean, how can you just not address that? How can you go right to childhood? But I was kind of upset when I saw that video of her, and I'm like, she's been writing books, she's been lecturing, you know, well-respected in the community, and saying very specifically, don't do traditional therapy, you're gonna do. Yeah.
And unfortunately, therapists don't even know enough to identify who's sitting in front of them. And I hear from people all over the world where they say, I've been seeing this therapist for years, and they're very interested in my story, but I don't want to pay them to keep telling my story, I want to get better. But the therapist doesn't know how to get better. And from where I'm standing, where I'm sitting, actually sitting at the moment, you know, borders on being unethical as a therapist to take a client that you're not trained to help. Just like someone who is not trained with addictions to work with someone with an addiction. You need to get supervision or you need to get trained. But unfortunately, again, it's just not identified. I can also tell you throughout the last however many years of the DSM, cults used to be labeled the 300.15, dissociative disorder, NOS. Then they took out the word cults and left it brainwashing. And to be honest, I'm not sure what's in the DSM-5 because I haven't looked yet. But there's a lot of political lobbying by cults, not wanting the public, and especially the US government, who did the most research on mind control. They don't want the public to know that this is how it's done, even though it's everywhere to be found, in my books and other people's books and on the internet, and watching TV shows like Homeland and everything else. It's ubiquitous, but again, it's a major mental health problem.
And Margaret Singer was harassed, like really, like someone put rats in her house once, I think, because she spoke out against cults. So the main.
Well, they sue and they harass people
yeah.
who speak out. There's so much more I want to say. I see we have about 10 more minutes. I want to ask other more questions, and we can come back and I can cover some more of the detailed stuff. Anything that you think we didn't cover, David?
I mean, in my mind, I just keep coming back to the central issue of identification. When you're working with someone, when you have someone sitting in front of you,
mm-hmm.
Who is still in a mindset of being, you know, having that cult mind, having that cult identity still being very strong within them. It not being something where, you know, someone's going to likely come in with this as a presenting problem, say,
almost
here because I was just in a cult.
Right.
And it's not something that is likely to be sort of identified through direct questioning in the same way that, you know, we might do a normal initial assessment.
Mm-hmm. That's why you need to add questions like, were you ever involved with a person or a group that was considered to be high demand or high, what's the other word, controversial by anyone, or were you ever involved in a relationship where you were felt some isolation, or where you were discouraged from reading certain things or from going certain places or not getting medical treatment, or ever be part of an organization that if someone started questioning the leadership, you would be dissuaded from interacting with them or shunning. I have a theory that if someone could actually do research into suicide attempts as well as inpatient psych wards, that there'd be a high percentage of former Jehovah's Witnesses. high percentage that are misdiagnosed and are being medicated, and the root of their problem is they were in a mind control cult and no one's ever taken the time to even think about the fact that they can get better, get out of that label of psychotic, delusional, borderline.
Are there any particularly good readings about that group in particular, since it is so big?
Jehovah's Witnesses?
Yeah.
Yeah, there's many, many. There's a new organization. The website is aawa.co. freeminds.org and freeminds2.org are two huge ones. And coming back to the question about isolation, I mean, realizing, hey, I'm not the only one. And, oh, Steve was in a crazy group, and he's doing okay. You know, it destigmatizes it. I have a friend who has a movie that just came out a week ago called Dumbbells. It's a point for my friend Hoyt Richards. He was the first male supermodel in the world in the 80s. And he was in the space alien cult for 20 years and didn't see his family for 12 years and gave over $4.5 million to his cult leader. And he made this movie based on a character who was a male supermodel who had been in a cult and the cult was coming after him and stuff. And part of our desire is to destigmatize the fact that intelligent, educated people can be deceived and mind controlled, and there's life after cult mind control, and there's full recovery. And we've heard about a lot of people who've been coming out of Scientology, Lawrence Wright's book, Going Clear, and such, but the problem that I had with Lawrence Wright's book, as great as it is, it had two pages on mind control. It didn't explain it in any real sense. Like, I went through the bike model with you, and I mentioned Lifton and some of the continuum. It's like they could have done that in a few pages, and it would have actually helped people, instead of saying, listen to these crazy stories and how these brilliant people gave so many years of their life and gave up all their money. So, yeah, I'm advocating a coming out of the closet for sexual abuse victims like that, coming out of the closet for people who are in cult mind control situations and just saying, happened to me, and so what? Like, it's now made me stronger, and it's helped me have a bit deeper understanding of myself and other people and belief systems and such. I think a lot of people get out, but they throw the baby out with the bathwater because they haven't done the homework to sort through. So people who have a deep spiritual need are afraid to open a Bible or go to a church, or someone who's in a meditation cult, like transcendental meditation, it's a direct another group that's really bad, that is a good rep. They give up meditation instead of realizing, you know what, it's the cult that's the problem, not the fact that you're learning a technique for how to influence your mind, you know, or stop negative thoughts, or stop thinking, or be with your breath. And what I'm seeing more and more are people who are former members who get mental health training and now they're doing therapy. So there's a movement happening that's really wonderful. And I'm just, you know, inspired by, you know, thank you for sharing, because hopefully everybody in this room will keep this in the back of their head as they're doing intakes and hearing people's stories and questioning, you know, hey. So what could have some of your therapists said or done or asked you that would have made a huge difference?
Well, I think I mentioned, you know, asking what if they had said, is there anything that your husband's saying that you agree with?
That's a good question. Well, what's the name of the church?
Well, I told them.
Google search.
Yeah, I told them the name.
Right, but they didn't do the search.
No.
What is the International Church of Christ? How is it different from the mainstream church of Christ?
I think we're so afraid of stepping on anyone's religion that as soon as it's like a religion, then, you know, gotta respect them. And, you know, I'm a nurse, so I deal with, you know, Jehovah's Witnesses who don't want to receive blood products and stuff, and this whole experience has made me really rethink that.
And the history of that group, they didn't, you know, the founder didn't have a problem with blood. It was Rutherford, the second president, I think, that came up with the blood, that a misreading of Jewish texts about kosher laws, that you shouldn't eat blood, and somehow they're taking it literally, and literally kidnapping people out of hospitals so they're not given blood transfusions. Mm. And countless numbers of people have died for absolutely no reason other than the governing body of this authoritarian group said so.
I think there's such a secular focus of therapy because it came away from, the people thinking that mental illness was demon possession, so that's its history. So there's such a secular focus that one of the pieces that was missing that Steve has really encouraged me to do is really go into the Bible and figure out what do I believe now and kind of like undo all that. Let's take away the cultic connotations of it and just do, I know, I don't believe the Bible is the word of God, like inerrant word of God, but I'm actually tomorrow night meeting with I don't know if he's a minister, he's an expert in my cult, and he's a Christian, so we're going to go through some of the Bible. I mean, it's taken me a long time to get to the point where I'm like, I bought a Bible in August, and I almost vomited. Mm. Like, I'm just like, whoa, you know. But I'm doing that work, but I think no therapist would ever encourage that, I don't think. Like, what do you believe? You know, you have to figure that out. Most, at least my therapists, the ones that I've had, when I talk about anything that comes from the Bible, they're like, I can see the cringes in their eyes, you know, it's like not on their face because they're trained, you know, but it's like, wives submit to your husbands, you know.
I really like Karen Armstrong's work. Are you familiar with History of God? She was a nun who ran away from the convent and became one of the world scholars of religions.
Spiral staircase, exactly.
But the History of God, it gives you an intellectual frame to understand and where to put this stuff as opposed to Jesus says.
She also tells you that her own story of kind of leaving the convent after 8 years, which is really fascinating because that is mainstream Catholicism.
You bet.
But I will tell you though that, like, you know, that I know this is cheesy, but the movie The Sound of Music, you know, that climb every mountain, like where Maria is like goes and says, should she be a nun or should she go marry this man? And the answer is you have to go find out, you know. And I listen to that song and I think that's what was, you know, that's what true spirituality is that finding what it is that you believe that God wants for you, whether it's God or whatever you call it, you know. And that song helps me because that's like, oh, that's the difference. You know, where is the choice coming from? You can make a choice to like shave your head and go live in the desert. If that's your free choice, then there's nothing wrong with that. But it has to. And you can't tell looking at the outside. You can't always tell from looking in the outside.
And when you're in it, you can't tell from looking at the inside.
You can't tell from looking at the inside or the outside.
So we're wrapping up, but I want to leave you with an important thing that I often do in my interventions and my prep meetings, which is I ask people the rhetorical question, how would one know if they were under mind control? How would anyone know that they were under mind control? And then I let people, you know, struggle for a few minutes and come up with things. Well, you wouldn't know, or, you know, someone would be telling you what to do or something like that. And then, but because we're running out of time, I'll give you my prescription. You wouldn't know in the here and now. You'd have to do geographical dislocation, get away from the person, the group. Don't do the group practices for at least a week. Don't talk to anybody from the group or the person for at least a week. Study the models of mind control. The three main ones are the Lifton model, the Singer model, and the Bite model. Deliberately seek out critics, ex-members. Hear all the negative information that seek it out that the group or the person didn't want you to hear. If you're in a relationship, go call up your old friends, your girlfriends or boyfriends who were saying, don't get involved with her or don't get involved with him, he's bad news. And say, tell me why again. You know, what behaviors were you seeing that were worrying you, etc. Reflect over your own firsthand experience with total honesty with yourself. And then if needed, go back to the group and start asking questions and watch their reactions. And if they are attacking you and defensive and making you feel like there's something wrong with you, it's saying something very strongly negative about the environment. Or if it's being accountable and responsible, then it's probably a healthier thing in your first thought. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So it's a process that needs to happen of reality testing. Thanks again.
Thanks so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much, love.
Thank you. Thank you for coming.